always plan your writing. You must always think that how you want to structure your poetry or prose. You know, that that organization of thought must be there. Then that makes actually that makes very effective, right? So that organization of thought is very important. The correct diction is very important. Emotions and the tone, these two are also very, very important. So all these attributes are found more controlled in poetry than in prose. Okay, so these attributes, what we are talking about, thoughts, diction, emotions, and tone, these are very controlled in poetry, but not that much in prose writing. So here we have a little bit of flexibility, but in poetry writing, it is very rigid. So we have to understand this. So the beat of the language is very vital. Why? The rise and the fall of the tone. Okay, so when you are going to, you know, rise the tone of the sentence, or where you have to have a falling tone, you know, that is also very important. So, and that the tonal nuisance, you know, emotions bring. So emotions, sometimes that emotions, you know, rises the tone also, and it also, you know, brings down also. So that control you need to have. So even though this rise and fall contributes to the rhythm, which is undertaken selectively, that is the choice of sounds. So what kind of sounds you use, you know, what kind of words you choose, what kind of structures you use here. We'll look into the next section where we talk about metrical system. Okay, so thus rhythmic patterns and the function of the meter makes a poem move onward. So what is a meter? Meter is a combination of stressed and unstressed syllables. You can see that when we are speaking English, you know, we are stressing, right? English is a stressed language. You all must know that. That's why when we are speaking English, we know where to have the stress, and that adds to the tone of the, you know, speech. But in writing, you cannot see that tone. But where in writing you use the right punctuation mark, that is very important in writing. Okay, that is also very important in speaking also, the punctuation marks, though we can't see, but we can understand this. Okay, this is one sentence which is ending, and the next sentence it is starting. This is the end of a paragraph or an idea, and the next idea starts. So we can automatically understand this thing. Right, if you know the language which the writer has written. So if you both, the writer and the reader both have the same language, then definitely it is not a big problem. But if you have to, suppose if I have to read a Chinese poetry, or if I have to read a Mandarin, you know, story, or Japanese, for example, or any other language, if I don't know those language, then it will be very difficult for me to balance and understand that where is the tone, which tone suggests what. So most of the languages are also tonal languages. So, you know, in some of the languages are not tonal. So those people who doesn't understand the idea of tones, tones like, you know, high tone, falling tone, you know, middle tone, level tone, all these things, if somebody doesn't have an idea, then he will never understand. So like, for example, in some of the Tibeto-Burman languages, you know, they're highly tonal. So one word might, if you rise the tone of that word, then it may mean something. If you have a falling tone, it may mean the, another thing. But the word is the same when you write. When you write, you can get the meaning from the context. But also when you speak also, that is, you can also derive from the context the meaning. But then if you have the right tone, it gives it more, it makes it more effective. Okay, this is all I have to tell you about what is that call of what do you mean by stressed and unstressed syllables. So these are a particular type of patterns of stressed and unstressed syllables. Each type is called a foot. The combination of feet in a line makes up a meter. So we look in this metrical structure that how these things work. Now you can see that there are four kinds of meters in English verse, such as iamb, troche, anapest, and dactyl. So what is an iamb? It's a metrical foot consisting of unaccented syllable followed by accented syllable. And what is a trochee? It has one accented syllable followed by one unaccented syllable, like tiger, tiger, burning bright. You know, this very famous poem by William Blake. So you can see accented syllable followed by one unaccented syllable. Here, the first word, tiger, 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 burning bright. So you can see, you can easily understand when I'm speaking, you can understand which one is accented and which one is not accented. In Anapest, it's composed of two unaccented syllables followed by accented syllable, like with a leap, with a leap. Now, leap, I'm accenting it, I'm stressing it. With a, I'm not, stressing it. With a leap. So you can see, you can have a lot of other such examples. And these examples are very much available everywhere. You can easily get these examples. So ductile is composed of one accented syllable followed by two accented syllables. So if you can recognize these four kinds of metrical fit, you'll be well on your way to reading poetry in a clearer and more natural sounding way. So the main point here is that when you write a poetry, you know, it should be very natural. There should be a flow. There's smooth flow. Okay, only then that essence or the flavor of that poetry comes out. So the next step, of course, is to determine why that matters. How meter can be used not only to read a poem or song, but also to interpret it. So this is where, again, a very important factor you must, the learner must, understand that why is it that it matters most? How meter can be used not only to read a poem or song, but also to interpret it. You can interpret it. Many of the songs you listen, you know, they have lyrics. And how many of you do understand the meaning of those lyrics? And you can see some of the lyrics, some of the songs which you have listened during your early childhood, that still now you remember this. Why do you remember this? Because of this tone, because of that, it was so natural and it was so rhythmic that, you know, you even if you're 50-year-old, 60-year-old, you'll never forget that. So, and whenever you want to sing, those songs comes to your mind because that is a very natural, spontaneous, smooth flow. So this is where, you know, meter is a poetic measure related to the length and rhythm of the poetic life. And it helps to pattern, thereby imparting a tangible body and form to an otherwise abstract looking poem. So this meter, when you understand this meter, then it gives, you are very much confident in writing a poetry. So the last part of this discussion is innovations. So what is an innovation? Innovation results from the poet's experiments with both form and content of the poetry. When we are talking about form and content, then this is very, very important that we have to look into that content of the poetry. Innovation in writing bring new fresh elements into the work.